The magic of Disney lies in their ability to take timeless stories and transform them into a pop culture phenomenon. Many of the stories that they use as the sources for their hit movies are extremely different from the movie we end up enjoying in the theater. From why she's called Cinderella, to what the Little Mermaid really did to get those legs, here are 8 real stories behind Disney fairy tales. Number 8, Beauty and the Beast. This is a tale as old as time. An enchanted hidden mansion in the French countryside. A girl in a flowing yellow dress, swinging around a gorgeous ballroom with a prince concealed in a beast form. Sassy, overprotective talking objects like candles, teapots, and clocks with big personalities. Of course, I'm talking about Beauty and the Beast, the Disney classic. It's a tale of a beautiful young girl who gets captured by an unruly beast and forced to live in his castle. The magical twist is that she falls for him, and the power of love breaks the spell and he regains his true form. And because it's Disney, they live happily ever after. However, the actual origin of this story, what sparked Disney's idea for the film, while it was inspired by historical events, it is not so romantic. The true story was inspired by the tale of Petrus Gonzalves. Petrus Gonzalves was born in Spain with a rare genetic condition called hypertrichosis, or werewolf syndrome. This means that the body isn't aware that it needs to stop growing hair, and it grows to cover the body, face, and more, thus making a person look non-human. Due to him being born in 1537, it wasn't fully understood what he was and wasn't at the time. When he was a young lad, his parents sold him to pirates, who would later present him to Henry II in an iron cage as a gift and seen as a wild mythical man, which turned out to be a stroke of good luck for Petrus. The king, however, discovered that Petrus was not as wild as people wanted to believe. He actually had a sweet and calm nature. Henry decided that he would transform him into a true gentleman. Aw, that's nice of him. He would teach Petrus how to speak, read, and write in 3 languages in the royal court, and his social status would rise tremendously. After Henry died, his widow, the infamous Catherine de Medici, found Petrus a wife, also named Catherine. The couple had 7 children, 4 that were born with the same werewolf syndrome as their father. They were sent as gifts to other European courts. Thus, the tale as old as time was born, and the famous love story of Beauty and the Beast came to be. Obviously, in the Disney movie, the man had a bit of a happier ending, as Belle was able to save him and through their love, transform him back into a regular, less hairy-looking man. That didn't happen to Petrus in regards to the transformation, but you can guess why Disney did it in the animated film. Number 7, Snow White and the 7 Dwarfs. Snow White and the 7 Dwarfs is one of the most famous and appreciated fairy tales in the world. First related in 1812 when the Grimm brothers published their collection of tales that had been gathered from old European folk stories. Like many other Grimm tales, it is supposed that Snow White and the 7 Dwarfs has been passed in existence since the Middle Ages, passed down through word of mouth over the centuries. The version that is universally told today and the most digestible by a non-adult audience, and in 1937, Walt Disney's first animated feature film, popularized the tale all over the world. Yes, Snow White, the sweet story of an innocent young beauty who is banished by a vain, cruel, and jealous stepmother, and who, with the help of 7 lovable dwarfs, ultimately finds her everlasting true love. But things get a bit darker if you really dive into it. In the 1857 version of Snow White, the queen and stepmother doesn't ask the huntsman to bring back the little girl's heart like she does in the movie. Instead, she asks for Snow White's lungs and liver. Turns out the huntsman was a big softy and couldn't perform this act, and so he fools the evil stepmother by bringing the lungs and liver of a young boar instead. She then boils them in salt and eats them. Ew, but awesome. Sweet and innocent Snow White runs off with the dwarfs, who don't actually have the names and unique personalities that Disney gave them. The queen learns the truth and comes to the dwarfs' house not once, but 3 times. The 3rd time, the queen returns with what the brothers Grimm describe as a poisonous, poisonous apple. It's so poisonous you have to say it twice, apparently. One side of the apple is deadly, the other is not, and she convinces her stepdaughter to taste the apple by biting the wholesome side herself. Snow White finds nothing odd about it and takes a bite herself and then falls down dead. The dwarfs are unable to revive her, so they put her in a glass coffin. Classy. Many years later, a prince shows up at the house and sees the dead girl, and he falls in love with her, which you have to admit is really strange. He asks if he can buy the girl from the dwarfs, but they say no. He tells them that he will die if he can't see her every day for the rest of his life, and steals her. He's pretty kooky, huh? As his servants are carrying her home, they drop her, and the jolt effectively performs the Heimlich maneuver on Snow White. A chunk of poison apple comes flying out of her mouth, and she comes back to life. Yep, there is no kiss, just Snow White getting dropped. Zombie Snow White and the prince get married, and the evil stepmother is invited to the wedding. Here's the best part. When she sees Snow White is alive and married to a prince, she is so petrified with fright that she could not budge. Iron slippers had already been heated over a fire, and they were brought over to her with tongs. Finally, she had to put on the red-hot slippers and dance until she fell down dead. Given all of this, you can see why Walt decided to soften the ending to a coma versus death and have Snow White get revived by a prince while the evil queen was chased to her doom. Hey, real quick, if you're new to the channel, welcome. Give this video a like and be sure to subscribe for more videos like these. Number 6. Cinderella. We all know the story of Cinderella. The poor orphan girl raised by her evil stepmom and tormented by evil stepsisters. A fairy godmother and singing animals craft her a beautiful dress and glass slippers she wears to a ball where she woos a dreamy prince but turns back into herself at the stroke of midnight. The prince finds one of the slippers, finds the girl, and they get a happily ever after. Aww. However, like many other fairy tales, the real tale, written by the Grimm's brothers, is a bit darker. No bippity-boppity-boos. So here it goes. Cinderella is not the real name of the protagonist. We actually never know anyone's real name in the story. It starts with her mother's last words before dying of an unknown illness, encouraging her daughter to always be good and kind-hearted. The loss of her mother breaks Cinderella's heart, and she spends every day at her mother's grave. After some time, her father marries a woman who has two daughters already. Not really sure what happened to the father, because who would actually let their daughter be treated the way she is? Her new stepfamily got rid of all her clothing and made her dress in rags and forced her to wear wooden shoes. Then they teased her for how she was dressed and even refused to allow her to sit in the same room as them. So mean. Their favorite means of tormenting the poor girl was to dump lentils into the fireplace ashes and force her to pick them out, clean them, and sort through the good and bad ones. This activity would cause her to be covered in ash and soot, hence the name of Cinderella. As the story goes on, the father goes on a journey and asks the girls what they want him to bring back for them. The stepsisters, of course, want jewels and fine clothing, while Cinderella just asks that he bring back the first twig that brushes his hat on the way home. Way to aim high, girl. Anyways, he does this and she plants the twig at her mother's grave, which then grows into a beautiful, magical tree. A 3-day ball is announced so the prince can find a bride. Everyone is invited to go, but Cinderella's stepmom won't let her. With her sisters and mother already at the ball, Cinderella goes to the tree and begs for a dress. The finest dress falls from the tree and Cinderella goes to the ball, dances with the prince, leaves after the party, and returns each night for all 3 nights, each time with a more magnificent dress. The 3rd night's escape, her golden, not glass, slipper falls off, and the prince begins his now famous hunt through the land to find the foot that fits the slipper. Oh, and remember the stepsisters? They were so desperate to fit into the shoe, they cut off their own toes and heels to do so. The prince noticed this and realized they couldn't have been the one he danced with. He found Cinderella, and when she tried on the slipper, that was for sure soaked with blood by now, it fit, and they ride off and get married. Yeah, thankfully, that version didn't make it into the film. Number 5. Sleeping Beauty. Everyone knows the story of Sleeping Beauty. A princess is cursed to sleep until her true love wakes her with a kiss. But the original version of the Sleeping Beauty story is very different from the classic Disney movie, and of course, much, much darker. There are some things that were the same, including the princess getting cursed by a spinning wheel and a piece of flax put her into a deep coma. Her father was crushed by this and just left her in the castle while he went and did something. A second king would eventually find her, and though she was still asleep, he made love to her. He then too would ditch her in the castle. She remained asleep, and 9 months later gave birth to twins, also while being asleep. Super weird. Once the babies were born, two fairies appear to help care for them. This story is already way too dark for Disney, and at this point, it takes another strange turn as the fairies try to help the newborns get nutrients by sucking their sleeping mother's fingers. One of the twins ends up sucking out the flax, which had put her into the coma, and she wakes up. Now, usually someone would probably be pretty freaked out by all this, but instead, she just awakens and starts taking care of the babies. The king comes back to claim his children, obviously not giving too much thought to the sleep birth. You would think that Sleeping Beauty would be pretty ticked off about everything and demand child support, but instead, she falls in love with him and they begin a romantic relationship. Of course, the king also leaves out that he's already married. This is why there was some heavy editing to make it not just a better story, but actually appropriate for kids and parents to watch, without a ton of awkward questions. Number 4, The Little Mermaid. There was a point in time when Disney, with Walt now passed away, was not making good films. They had a series of flops before they eventually hit it big with The Little Mermaid, which still stands out as a classic to this day. There's an infinite amount of tales about mermaids in our world, but the origins of The Little Mermaid will make you wish she wasn't part of your world. You see, in the original story by Hans Andersen, the mermaid visits a sea witch and drinks a potion that exchanges her tongue, because apparently she has the most intoxicating singing voice, for a pair of beautiful human legs and a soul, which the mermaid didn't have. What Disney leaves out, though, is that walking on her new legs will constantly feel like sharp swords and make her bleed. In addition, she will only get a soul if she finds true love's kiss and if the prince loves and marries her, for then a part of his soul will flow into her. Okay. Otherwise, at dawn, on the first day after he marries another woman, the Little Mermaid will die brokenhearted and disintegrate into sea foam. The Little Mermaid drinks the potion and meets the prince, who is attracted to her despite her being mute. She dances for him despite it causing her excruciating pain. The king wants the prince to marry a princess from a neighboring castle, but he doesn't love her. He goes on to say that he could only truly love the girl who rescued him from something at the temple, who actually turns out to be the other princess. So they get married and the Little Mermaid is heartbroken. She thinks about all she gave up and suffered for this prince. The mermaid sisters went to visit the sea witch and exchanged their long hair for a knife, which they gave their depressed sister. The sea witch said that if she slays the prince with the knife and lets his blood drip on her feet, she could become a mermaid again and get on with her life. But since she loved the prince, even though he didn't love her, she couldn't harm him. She throws herself into the sea, but instead of turning into sea foam and ceasing to exist, she turns into a spirit and is able to gain a soul by doing good deeds for 300 years. Wow, that is quite an edit on Disney's part. Number 3, Aladdin. A rags-to-riches Disney classic through and through, Aladdin was so popular that it not only had two sequel movies, but an animated cartoon show made about it on Disney Channel. And when you look at the source material, you'll find some very similar story beats, with a few exceptions. The original story is a series of translations of an incomplete manuscript of a medieval Arabic story collection that dated back to the late 14th century. The original version of Aladdin's story has him living not in the Middle East, but in China. That right there transforms the vibe of the story if you really think about it. Another huge difference is that Aladdin is not actually a street smart orphan or a street rat, if you buy that, just barely able to get by, fending for himself and dodging city guards. Instead, he's just a lazy kid who is a huge disappointment to his family. Kind of a big difference there too. In the original story, the genie was not the hilarious, awesome, charismatic character ironically portrayed by the late great Robin Williams. Instead, he was a rather ugly looking guy who wasn't even really blue. However, he does grant Aladdin some wishes, but not just three. That's right, the classic only three wishes, use them wisely, was not in the original tale. Also, there are two genies in the original story, one less powerful and one more powerful. But anyways, Disney did get it right when they have Aladdin wish to become a prince so that he could marry a beautiful princess. However, the manner in which he did that involved him sabotaging the marriage that she had already been planning to another man. Number 2. Pocahontas. Pocahontas is a very curious Disney movie because it tries to paint what happened between the colonists and the Native American people in a much more positive light. Try to keep up with this story. First off, yes, Pocahontas was real, which was part of the appeal of the story. However, Pocahontas was her nickname. It means ill-behaved child. Not the nicest thing to call a Disney princess, wouldn't you say? John Smith was captured by her tribe when he first arrived on their land. The tribe was planning on killing him, but Pocahontas risked her life to save him by standing up for him. Her father, the chief, then called Smith his son. She then began visiting Jamestown, the place the colonies built on the natives' land, and had relations with them. She would exchange food with Smith's colony for tools for her tribe. Colony leaders then gave the chief a newly arrived boy, Thomas Savage, because apparently exchanges like that were common, and Pocahontas would help the boy adjust to his new life. Soon the Englishman's constant demand for food that was already scarce made the chief want to get out of the deal, and he and the others in the tribe planned to slay the colonies in their sleep. Pocahontas warned Smith of this, and he tried to reward her, but she didn't take the gifts because then the tribe would know that she had betrayed them. A bit of time passed and more Englishmen showed up, and this time they decided to kidnap 14-year-old Pocahontas and keep her prisoner in exchange for food and the men the tribe had apparently kidnapped too. Jamestown leaders soon discarded the plan of using her and instead now saw her as the key to their success. A man named John Rolfe fell in love with her and taught her about his faith. She then announced publicly that she also had the same faith, and she changed her name to Rebecca Rolfe. Pocahontas did, in fact, make the crucial contribution to Virginia's success, but in a way that completely surprised everyone. Colonists had been trying to grow tobacco for years, but without success. She understood the crop and the environment and helped tobacco transform Virginia from a money drain to an economic success, as smoking went from a pastime for the elite few in Europe to something everyone could afford. She moved to London with John Rolfe and they had a son, but she became very ill and died at the age of 20. Can you see now why they went to such lengths to make this seem like a much better story? History is not as kind as a Disney movie, and they no doubt wanted Pocahontas to seem more happy in her ever after. Sadly, it wasn't really the case. Number 1. Mulan. Many people were introduced to the warrior woman Mulan in the Disney animated film of the same name. If you've seen the movie, you saw that Mulan wasn't actually a princess, but the daughter of a common warrior, though we let her into the Disney princess group because, well, she's a badass. Because though real and imagined alike, these characters inspire us to stand up for what is right, no matter the cost. The original Mulan story is quite different from both Disney's 1998 animated film and the new live-action movie. The earliest printed version of the story, still in existence today, was first featured in an anthology in the 12th century known as The Ballad of Mulan. It's a short poem thought to have originated as a folktale in the 4th and 5th century. The gist of the ballad tells of how Mulan replaced her aging father to serve the country, disguised herself as a man, and fought bravely in the army. A stark contrast, unlike the movie we know. She was already a warrior before leaving home because her father had trained her from a young age. You go, girl. Furthermore, unlike the movie, she didn't have to run away from home to take her father's place. Rather, they fully supported her and felt it was natural for her to go and be a warrior. Now, yes, she did go and hide her gender at first, but eventually, she was the one who revealed her truth to the world, and they too supported her. When she returned and attended the court after the army's victory, she didn't want an official award, but she just asked to be reunited with her family. After, she changed into her own clothing at home. Her comrades were all shocked that she was a girl. This really makes you wonder why Disney did a lot of dumbing down, if you will, to make Mulan seem meeker and less confident than the original poem. Were they just trying to play the Disney princess stereotype? What do you think? Thanks for watching. What do you think of the real stories behind these Disney fairy tales? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Bye!